lost and all alone. No one hit your phone up, your internet is slow. There's a place you can go and you can call home. When you're kinda blue and outside it's raining, Spotify your favorite dudes. There's a place you can go and you can call home. One big family, not just you and me. BARONG family loves ya, best gang in the world. From China to The Hague, from Bali to LA, family matters.
What's up, guys? Welcome to another episode of BARONG Family Radio. My name is Nils. And this time we had a good talk with our friends Moksi, and not in Amsterdam as usual. This time we're in China, in Sanya to be exact. And we kind of lost track of time, and we just accidentally made a double episode. So we don't want to cut anything out because everything is just pure knowledge and too sweet not to broadcast. So what we're gonna do? We're gonna cut this thing in half. Why not? So we're gonna make two episodes. So welcome. This is part one, BARONG Family Radio with Moksi. So while Jim is actually eating a Toblerone bar,
yeah. Like, and this is we didn't discuss this before the interview, but
it's in my rider.
A big classic
Toblerone,
chocolate bar.
Honeygram.
I'm even kidding. It's a thing on our social media these days. The Toblerone.
Is it?
Yeah, it is.
Why?
Yeah. Because I was in Prague.
On your social media?
On our Moksi profile.
Uh-huh. No shit.
On our stories, yeah. You should check it out today, even today.
I never checked them.
Yeah. So I thought it was a joke. You came out with the Toblerone.
No,
I was like, I thought you were making a joke for the interview.
No.
But what's the thing? What's the pun?
The thing was, I opened like the minibar at a hotel, and every time in the minibar there's a Toblerone bar.
Yeah.
But you never see them anywhere else in the world. Only in minibars.
And airports. And
supermarkets.
Yeah, okay, but I don't.
7-Elevens too.
Maybe I didn't notice.
Airports.
Where does it come from? Is it Switzerland?
It's Swiss, yeah. It's Swiss. And it was a joke. I just asked the fans, like,
I saw that. The pronunciation thing.
Yeah.
I saw that.
And then, yeah, it became a thing now. I don't know.
That's something good.
And
in
what's
Spain, we say Toblerone.
So what's the thing? People bring Toblerone bars to shows?
Yeah, yeah, actually they do.
That's
now.
Perfect.
Yeah, yeah.
Just cool. Grow some all and, like, sell them.
Yeah. Okay.
But
yeah, we tried it for a while, talking about money, see if people will bring us money, but...
And they actually do now, right?
They still bring us books and Poki.
Poki.
But right now, actually, we're in China. We're in Sanya, to be exact. And yesterday, a Chinese promoter told us this wasn't an island, but it is an island,
actually. An island.
So pretty embarrassing. But so it's an island. It's a pretty tropical part of China.
I think it's even the most southern part of China.
Yeah, so it's close to
Taiwan,
to Vietnam, I think. Right?
It's close to Vietnam.
Taiwan, yeah. Right? Oh, it's Vietnam.
It's not close to Taiwan at all.
Yeah, right.
It depends on where you are in Sanya.
Yeah, right. Actually,
and it's a good place to be. They have a beach. They have coconuts,
swimming pools, sea.
Yeah,
nice resorts. We just went to the aquarium.
Big water parks.
Private helicopters.
Helicopters.
And we're here because of what? What's
pretty fancy, actually.
Yeah, it's pretty fancy.
Yeah. Because we're playing YSY.
Yes.
With a whole BARONG Family crew. So we've been trying to do a radio show with Moksi for ages, but they keep rejecting us.
Avoiding us.
You guys are on holiday.
Yeah,
we
don't like the questions. We don't like your agenda. We don't like your political stand.
We don't like your new hairstyle.
The secret agenda.
You're not paying us enough.
because we finally
got them cornered. Under the ruse, like, hey, are you coming to the villa for a swim?
This is the sixth episode, I guess.
It is, yeah.
Yeah, we started out with just ourselves.
Yeah, that was the most fun.
We still got a lot of comments like bring those guys back. Then we had Julian and Stolhoff.
Yep, we did one with GTA.
Who?
We did one with Radical Redemption.
I like one with GTA, by the way.
Yeah, that was good.
Fun, right?
We whack.
The one with Radical Redemption is really cool too. By the way. Yeah, it's cool. And
I wasn't there.
And we whack. Those were actually the best ones I did by myself. No, but the Radical Redemption one is—he's a great talker. So and he, yeah, he and he comes from a different scene and, yeah. And so yeah, and he does big ass concerts.
He's a legend.
So it was a really cool talk. Like, you know, he told me a lot of new stuff, so it's dope.
We're actually still working on a collab with him, but it's really hard to combine.
Same.
You should go to the we finished that one,
yeah,
actually.
Yeah,
we finished
our collab.
Yeah, it's impossible.
It's more easy for you guys. Like,
I think so too.
Yeah.
Hey, that's room service. That's a room service.
That's a nasi goreng.
Who's gonna get it?
I will open it though.
Diego, master of food.
Food master.
Well, yeah, we actually tried to do the first episode with Moksi and now they're here.
Yeah, finally.
Guys,
yeah.
What the fuck is up?
Yeah.
How are you guys
good,
doing?
Man.
Life is good, man.
It's the end of the year. Yeah. Did a lot of traveling, big shows.
Yeah, it's been a crazy year, man. I think we did about 130 shows or something this year, which is absolutely.
130?
130 shows, yeah.
That's
which
a lot.
Is crazy, yeah. And we haven't been home a lot, but we love life on tour. So, I mean, it's been good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Perfect. The thing we always ask, and that's like, it's a cool way for people to hear, like, what you guys do when you're not playing shows. But we're very interested. Like, how does a normal day for you guys look when you're just like at the office or in the studio? How does a day look for you?
Well, my ideal day is just wake up whenever I want.
What time?
It's just no alarm.
Perfect.
And then just wake up, brush my teeth, just keep like, I just, just brush my teeth, bro. I brush my teeth,
I've
get into it.
I've been trying to get Jim to do it.
I look at my eyes into the mirror, I'm like brushing this.
He doesn't believe in it.
you don't believe in brushing? No.
I don't believe in waking up either.
Yeah, it's a conspiracy, I know. Yeah. But then I just walk into the studio with no food. I don't eat, just start making music and just have no sense of time. That's my ideal day, actually, just to grind through the day, just to flow through time. And
your studio is in your home, right?
Yeah, it's in my backyard. I built that when I bought that house like 5-6 years ago, which was way like 2 years before Moksi started. And I built that house with a lot of debt on that house. I took a lot of risk building that studio, but it was worth it because we started making music there exactly the way I just described.
Yeah.
I was just
about to say, it sounds a lot like how you guys were making music before there was any business involved.
Exactly. Yeah, that's how I like to make music. Just no structure, no time, no, you know, that's it. Yeah.
Good. And Diego, for you?
I love to wake up a little bit early, go to the gym, just start my day like that. And normally I will drive to Venlo to hit the studio. Mm-hmm. I always have to drive to Venlo.
Yeah.
I'm fucked.
Because Sami lives in Venlo, and you live in?
Weird. Yeah.
I'm actually from Venlo too.
Yeah.
For the people at home that are not familiar with the more southern good cities in Holland, look it up. It's a really little town, small town, on the border of Germany.
Yeah.
And
there's a lot of music coming from Venlo.
Dolph comes from Venlo. Who else is from Venlo?
Ambu Gang.
Little shout out.
We got a lot of people coming from Venlo now. I'm jamming.
Me too. But the most important thing is Moksi Yellowclaw.
Yeah,
that's
exactly. That's
no, but
export.
That's actually how we, because you and I, Samir and Jim, for that matter, we've known each other for maybe even
20 years ago.
Maybe 20 years,
20
right?
20 years, yeah, at least. And that's a funny thing.
I even know you longer when we were kids. Because you used to be, maybe I know your brother longer.
Yeah, well, I know you because you used to you were friends with Mingus and Jim, my nephew.
Oh yeah, your cousin.
Yeah, my cousin. Yeah. And I remember seeing you there. You were there watching movies, playing games, and I was just like a small kid, like 8 years, 7 years old, and you were a bit older.
And your brother is a little bit older, right?
My brother is 2 years older.
Because I know your brother because he at a certain point I was DJing like R&B hip hop records.
Yeah.
And there was this one club, not even a club, it's like a bar.
Wallaby.
Yeah. No, before that, way before that. Yeah, after Wallaby and then there was the Begijn.
Begijn, yeah.
And they were the only ones that had like the turntables. And I think the owner, like, I think he paid me like $50 or something. Yeah. But I made this deal with him, Jesse. Yeah, like, okay, I'll play at your place. And this is when Holland was all about dance music. It was not like nobody was playing hip hop at all.
Yeah.
I'll pay you like the $50 or something. And I told him, like, I'll do it, but you have to give me $20 extra every week to buy vinyl.
Oh yeah.
And he said yes, and I was like, oh, I can't believe that idiot went for that. I needed the $50
anyway. You started out with vinyl. playing final.
Yeah, I actually went playing for him because he had the 1200s.
Sick.
The
and
Technics.
Then I used to buy like one or two or three records. But back then, like, you know, like...
Yeah, sounds.
Yeah.
Sounds fun.
And his brother always came.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because he was DJing himself. Yeah, yeah. His brother and Dolph.
Shout out DJ Tariq.
Shout out DJ Khatarik.
Remember? Yeah, that was his first.
Khatarik.
What a time.
That was
a
good, good name.
Yeah.
What was Roots? Nudy Rudy or?
No, Rude Boy.
Oh, yeah, Rude Boy. Yeah.
But they would be really young, like 17 or 16 or something. I was like 18 or 19. And they would basically be like on my hands. Like they would just stand next to the booth. And because all the vinyls would always turn around. They would like try to read what was on the vinyls. And that's how I met them. And one time your brother, I still have a record of his.
Oh, you told
I
me.
I still have the Usher album.
Yeah, you told me that. Yeah.
He left it there one day and I was just like, whatever.
I remember I was hosting your set on, what's it called?
That's the first time we met. Drop.
That's the first time we met. Yeah. And you didn't like that at all. Right?
Not at all.
I remember that festival. We played it as Yellow Claw too. Years later.
No, just as you and me, as Nizzle and but that first festival they did, it had Hardwell.
Yeah,
Afrojack. Yeah, it had
Sam O'Neill.
Sam O'Neill. This is the next chapter we're going.
Bass Jackers.
So Samir was playing there too as Sam O'Neill.
Yeah, it was. Yeah.
And you were pretty famous in our town.
Yeah, there was basically no other DJ that played like house music.
Yeah,
that's like, why I knew him.
Yeah,
because he was famous in the region. So
yeah, he was.
Yeah, and I started to throw parties and got involved with all the festival promoters and stuff. And yeah, that's how it started. And that's like, 10, 15 years ago.
Yeah.
You were playing some weird shit, right?
I was like playing weird shit.
Tech house.
Weird house music.
Yeah,
definitely European house music. Yeah,
trying to keep it credible.
Yeah, I was a fucking purist.
That's why you were in debt for having the house.
I didn't make any money.
What was your if you look at that time now and you would have to say three records that shaped that sound you were playing then, so people can Google it at home.
I would say check out the label Dubsided. That's an old label. I think it's a French label. I'm not sure what country it was from, but all the songs on that label, I have all those vinyls still at home, basically shaped our sound. It was a mixture between house music, fidget, UK bass, all these weird elements, but also like breakdowns with jazz samples and super weird music. And people in Venlo actually liked it, but you should check out that label, Dubsided. I can name three tracks, like I can name three artists: Jesse Rose, Solid Groove,
Lee Mortimer,
all those guys. Big influence, and you can still hear it, especially in our new stuff, even more than in our old stuff.
Hey, so 2017 obviously was your guys like arriving on the scene, pretty much. 2018 was a big year for you guys.
Yeah,
like. I'm just very curious, could you name like a couple like big shows
from the we did Tomorrowland five times already. We did EDC Vegas
main stage.
That
Orlando
was a big moment. But also selling out our first show in LA. I remember like standing there like thinking, damn, I'm just a fucking dude from Venlo. You know,
a long way from home
in LA. I mean, I would never thought I would even go there. Like from where I'm from, that's like, you know what I mean? That's far fetched.
I remember we were like playing the first time in LA. We were talking about this. Yeah. What was the venue called?
Create?
No.
Exchange?
No, I think it was Huntington Beach. It was the first. Oh no!
That one like in a small venue underground.
Oh, that was the Blood for Mercy tour. That was the first.
Oh, show. That was the release party.
Nicole Addison was there too.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But after that, we did our first solo tour in America. And then we did, I think we did Create, and it was sold out.
I love that place. It's renamed now, right?
Academy.
Yeah, we played there a while ago. It was popping.
Crazy.
They got the stuff on the.
But LA in general, man.
Yeah.
Do you guys like playing in the States?
Oh, I love it. I really love it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like, and they know, they understand the culture, they understand, and they want to discover new shit. I mean,
they know what's up.
I mean, can you expect, like, if you would have said 3 years ago that a house duo from Holland could have done a tour like that in the US, that would have been like, I don't know.
Yeah, maybe. And even somewhat of a niche.
Yeah,
it's house.
Exactly, from an independent label from Amsterdam. Yeah. It's not even an American act. I mean, it just blew up in America.
Yeah. But it's a big label, though.
It's a big independent label.
No, but definitely, yeah. I feel. But I've always felt like we at a certain point had like the same roads to go, and we had the same thing. Like the first time we went, it was like wow, these 800 people actually were at home tonight and thought, yo, Yalta's in town. Yeah, we should go there.
Yeah,
like,
let's buy a ticket.
And that like thousands of miles away from where you grow up, but it's still special.
Yeah, it's still special. But you're getting used to the fact that it's that far away because you're getting to know the cities and you know you're starting to create friendships in all the cities.
Yeah. So I love that part. Actually.
Yeah, that's really nice.
You can go to Chicago and did you have a couple friends there?
Yeah, I just hit them up. Like I'm in town.
Yeah, to dinner. Yeah. You know, to go to the party.
Which is also like a core essential of the label is trying to build that first like network. I know how I want to say it because I know that like if you go to Taipei, there's somebody there for you. If you go to Amsterdam, there's somebody there for you. If you go to like Dallas, there's somebody there for you. And I've seen a lot of people lately really connecting with each other, you know? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah, that's cool.
They get to know each other on like every part.
Yeah, and just somebody that takes you out. Somebody takes you out to like, tells you where to go, where to shop, where to eat, or where not to eat, like in certain countries.
Yeah, exactly.
Let me show you what's going on. now, now. Yeah. Started out with them pies and them pants. In the drought, get alive for a grand. With my wrist, look at it, fingers broke. Need my wrist, oh so cold, till it's froze. Ooh, damn, look at my wrist. Ooh, damn, look at my bitch. Ooh, damn, look at my wrist. Whip, 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 whip. Ooh, damn, look at my wrist. Ooh, damn, look at my bitch. Ooh, damn, look at my wrist. Whip, 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 whip. 100 bands, damn, that's 100 grand. Turn it up, I got love for my fans. From the blocks, with them blocks in them pants. Now I'm the man with them bands in my hand.
But and besides the States, I feel like Asia has opened up for you guys.
Yeah.
Lately, and which is really really interesting. What were like the highlights?
Yeah, I mean,
in there for you guys.
I mean, playing in Asia was a challenge at first because I mean house music wasn't big here ever. I mean that part of the EDM culture has never grown. Mm-hmm. Here yet, so when we started touring in Asia, we didn't know what to expect. Mm-hmm. But we started touring here with I think the BARONG Family World Tour. That was the first time we went here, and I noticed immediately that our sound connected well.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's not basic house music. It's very bassy. You know, it's definitely,
yeah, it has like a power to it. Like.
Yeah, definitely a lot of energy to it, and it works. It works. I mean, we've been touring here for like nonstop.
Which personally is one of the things I like about Moksi and the Moksi sound is that like pretty like deep housey people fuck with some of the stuff.
Yeah.
But some of the stuff is being played by some of the biggest EDM stars out there. Are just like whatever when it goes from maybe Chester or Steve Aoki and that's really interesting about you guys' sound and it has the balls and it has the brains at the same time, you know, and it's not.
We definitely want to stay in that like that angle.
Kind of shout out Looney Tunes.
So Looney Tunes are outside.
What do you guys? You wanna?
Oh shit!
You want us to open the door? Or like, what should we do?
There's a naked Looney Tune.
It seems like he's cold. If we wait a little longer, he might pass out. Oh, he's grabbing a chair now. No, I'm gonna open the door.
But because from. Straight from the get-go of your first EP, I remember that was really like a lightning strike, and it started being played by a lot of people. Who were the first supporters in that like more EDM-ish kind of scene for you guys?
From the EDM perspective or the deeper?
Both.
I mean, I remember AC Slater starting to play our songs, which made us feel really credible.
Yeah.
But then the week after, I saw a video of, I think it was Chesto playing one of our songs in like a club in Vegas.
I remember that video,
AC Slater inspired us as well, right?
Yeah, yeah. But then like that difference between all, I noticed that. I was like, whoa, okay. So we didn't know how to judge our own music yet because it was just so new and we just made it and we just released it and then we started to understand that this is something that covers all aspects of the EDM genre.
Definitely.
And that was really exciting and that made us clear for us. So every time we're in the studio, we just don't think about they have to play it or they have to. We just do what we want and basically that's the key.
Yeah, because I remember when you guys sent over the first demo of the first song.
Yeah.
I fuck with it because it had a very big two-step thing in it. Something that was really big in Holland, like mid-90s, I guess, end the 90s. Zeros, and then went to like to the whole fidget era, which the fidget era for me like got me into electronic music. Because back then I thought that the two-step thing was more of an sped up R&B-ish thing.
Yeah, it was black music. Definitely.
Yeah, you were listening to it because you fuck with Greg David or you fuck with like that kind of thing. And I remember getting that first demo and I already knew, we already knew you as Samir. I knew you as Diego and we were really like, damn, this is really something. Like this is...
Yeah, for me, I remember I was psyched about it because it had like normal house music is like 100% instrumental. Yeah. And I remember these three demos we heard were like 80% instrumental, 20% vocal. Mm. So not only like a 1-2-3 jump vocal line, but it had like vocals on the break a little bit and like chopped up stuff. And that already makes that kind of music way more accessible for people to understand it and feel it. And
yeah.
So well, it had a great vibe to it.
That what was your favorite record on that first EP? It was called Brace Yourself EP, right?
I love Brace Yourself, but I really love The Dopest as well.
Oh yeah,
it was on the first one, right?
That's a
I think Getting Higher is my favorite from the first EP. I think that's the first song we ever made. Actually, that's the first song we ever started.
Yeah,
to
yeah,
work
that's
on.
The first one. Yeah, yeah.
Oh yeah, wasn't it Break Yourself?
No.
Because that was the first one you sent.
So
No.
Getting Higher was the first one. Yeah.
No. It was actually Getting Higher that we sent for the first time.
And then you
call us and you're like, dude, make an EP, make three more songs, and then we started to work on the other three. But yeah, I mean, name a favorite. I mean, yeah, I saw the success of Brace Yourself. The song Brace Yourself was obviously the reason why it kicked off. But
And you still play all of these songs?
No. We made like 60 songs from like 3 years ago. So we just keep changing our set as we make new music. Mm-hmm. So some of these songs got lost.
And from this to the newest stuff you've been working on, how did your music change? Or did it even change?
It became bigger.
Should it even change?
It became bigger, way bigger. We started out like pretty underground-ish.
Just the music, just the production.
I mean, like for production side, it definitely evolved way more sophisticated and mixed downs, because the first EP, if you listen to it, like all the geeks out there, if you put it through a meter, a spectrum, it doesn't make any sense. Like the subs are off and the kicks are interfering with the subs. It was just fun.
But it was still a search to a sound. You know?
Definitely, yeah. And I can tell that like now when we're in the studio, it's way more sophisticated in production. But also the sound wise, we started to get way more into the fidget side, so very a bit crushy, distorted drums.
I fucking love that.
Doing more with vocals as well, more vocal cuts and everything.
Because honestly, if I listen to the stuff you guys working on right now, like the new stuff, it has way more layers.
Yeah,
so it's like fatter and like wider and like bigger and
definitely.
It even like sometimes it's more progressive, sometimes it's way more electronic. So it has like became more of like a diamond with more sides to it.
Yeah, that's how I feel too, and especially because there are more genres we're trying to incorporate into our music right now. So we actually have a new song. It's called Spike the Punch.
Yeah,
and it has a trance break.
I know it.
I
fuck with that song.
It's a weird ass fucking
song.
I fuck with
that song as well, man.
And that break is crazy.
Yeah, that's exactly.
And it's a weird drop.
It's a weird song, yeah.
But even the song you guys did with Hardwell,
The power
that break was so like throwback old school house music. Like we played it, we did the hell out of that. Song.
Yeah, that's a.
But what is the thing people can expect to drop now? Like first of all, have you guys got anything lined up? If you guys have anything?
Well.
Oh shit.
Well, we may or may not.
Yes. This was it, guys. Part one. Of two. Next episode is going to be all about Moksi and their plans for 2019. Stay tuned for the next episode, BARONG Family Radio. And this episode, we got a guest mix, of course, as usual, this time by BARONG Family legend in the meanwhile. His name is Bellorum. Let's get it.
Yo, it's Bellorum from France, and this is my guest mix for BARONG Family Radio.
back, back.
Gotta bring you back.
see you go.
Guarantee you won't forget me. All black walking in the nighttime, fool. I be blacking all the fuck out when I write rhymes, fool. If you feel me when you see me, say what up, my nigga. If you hating, I don't really give a fuck, my nigga. Stacked up and I cashed out. She backed up and then tapped out. We stepped in and it's hands down. We racked up on them racks now. I'm the one that got stacked down. I'm the one that won't back down.
every fucking day. I just can't believe all the things people say. Why must I deal with this shit every fucking day?
We don't waste time, hit him with the rhythm in the face, push him way back, take that.
Hit him with the rhythm. Let me see that booty pop. TikTok, booty cock. Let me see that booty pop.